you think of photons, and you can maybe wonder why we do not have a complex forms made from light. For example, if you have other particles such as electrons, atoms, they form complex structures. They form liquids. They form solids. And all our world around us are made from matter, which is basically quarks and leptons. But why we cannot make similar things with light? Lights are bosons, so in principle we could achieve a fluid of light, or even a superfluid of light, or maybe even a solid of light. So why that has not been possible so far? So one reason is that photons do not interact. Those particles, the cross-sections for the interaction between two photons is very small, and optical frequencies, in principle, the photons could interact via creation of electron-positron pairs, but in practice it doesn't happen because this process is extremely unlikely. So photons do not interact. That is one limitation why we cannot create a complex structure. Another limitation is that photons are massless. The rest mass of photons is zero. For any complex structure such as liquid or a solid to be built, this is a combination, this is a competition between kinetic and potential energy. So if photons don't have a mass and they don't interact, we don't have this notion and we cannot create more complex forms made of photons. However, this can be overcome nowadays, so we can cheat the nature and we can create artificially, we can give a photon a mass and we can give photons interaction. So how can we do that? So to give a photon a mass, it's enough to capture photons in one direction. If you you have your photons, and if you can create mirrors such that the photons will not escape outside of the mirrors, there will be the motion will be frozen in one direction. They will only be possible to move into other direction perpendicular to those mirrors. Then effectively, in this two other direction, it will mean that the photons will be massive. The photons will have a mass. This mass will be finite, but it will be very small. So it will be of the order of 10 to the minus 9 of typical atoms. And this is actually quite useful, because if the mass is very light, then any quantum effects which will appear at very high temperatures, even up to room temperatures. So we can fix the problem of the mass by capturing photons between two mirrors. The problem of interactions between photons can also be solved if you couple photons to something of the matter type, because if the photons will annihilate and create, let's say, an exciton in a medium, or if they will couple to some internal degrees of freedom inside an atom, for example, then via that other object the photons will effectively interact. So this was possible to be achieved either in semiconductor structures with electron-hole pairs, so excitons, or atoms placed in cavities where interactions between photons could be achieved by a coupling to this internal atomic degrees of freedom. So you could solve these two problems, the mass and the interaction between photons. And so because that was possible in experiments to be done, we could make photons interact inside that cavity. And in experiment, we were able to actually create a fluid of light. So interacting photons with a mass, which is very similar to any other fluid. And in particular, because the mass is so light, it was possible to achieve quantum effects, such as, for example, superfluidity at very high temperatures. So now we can step back a little bit and ask what is superfluidity. So superfluidity is a state of matter. It's a new state of matter where microscopic number of particles, a very large number of particles, form one object. They behave collectively, they behave together, because they occupy the same state. So now, because each atom is not individual entity anymore, if the atoms start flowing, or if the photons now, in our case, we're talking about photonic superfluidity, start flowing, they will flow without any disturbance. They can, in case of liquid helium, for example, it's a famous example, where they can flow up even a container and escape from the container. Or if they flow and they meet an obstacle in the middle of their flow, they will not scatter, they will not see the obstacle. So if we look far away from the obstacle, it will look as our superfluid is not having any resistance to anything, it doesn't see anything. So that was possible to be created for photons, coupling them to electron-hole pairs in semiconductors forming polaritons. So once the quantum fluid was created, once the superfluid was created, it allowed injection of quite an interesting object there. We could put a vortices inside such a superfluid. We could inject persistent currents into the superfluid. Observation of the frictionless flow was possible. So our photons were doing a very similar thing to what liquid helium or electron-hole pairs in superconductors. So flowing without resistance, not seeing any obstacle on the way, and supporting persistent current, supporting vortices. So then we went a step further in experiments in various groups, looking at the transition between a normal state and the superfluid state in the case of these interacting photons. And it was possible to see that very similar, like for the matter particles, the transition between the normal and the superfluid state is happening via creation and annihilation of vortex-antivortex pairs, so binding and unbinding of those pairs. So in the same spirit as Kosterlitz-Thouless transition. So we already had our quantum fluid, which now can be used as a laboratory to explore quantum turbulence, to explore behavior of vortices, behavior of solitons there. But now we wanted to go one step further. So now we have a fluid, we have a superfluid. Why can we not create a solid out of light? And that's a very new area of research at the moment. We can do that because we can create a potential for light. There are various ways of doing that. One can put some different pieces of a different material with different refractive index on the top of our mirrors and giving effective potential for light. Or one can put a surface acoustic wave, so modulate the energy for photons via external sound waves. One can do very drastic things like edge micropillars. So instead of having two-dimensional structure, one can make one-dimensional lattices out of the semiconductor. So there are various ways of creating potentials for photons. And if now you place a photon which has a mass and interactions inside a potential, then you create something which is the same as in the case of solids. And why would we be interested in doing that? So as I said, the photons have very light mass, so the quantum effects are happening at very high temperatures. So now, by creating these artificial lattices for photons, we can try to model, we can try to quantum simulate some other materials which are much more complicated to study than photons. And moreover, this is already a quite an active field in the area of ultra-cold atoms. But ultra-cold atoms have their limitations. Firstly, they have to be cooled to extremely low temperatures. Here, with polaritons, with photons, we can be almost at the room temperature. That's one advantage of that system. Another advantage is that the mirrors are never ideal, so there will always be some leakage of photons coming out of these cavities. And by capturing the photons and measuring their energy, their momentum, and their position, we know everything about the system inside. So we know not only the ground state, we know all the excitation spectrum of the system, which can be resolved in space. So the amount of information which is given in that system is by far much larger than the information which can be drawn from other platforms like ultra-cold atoms, for example. So at the moment, the photons inside those lattices are still in a so-called semi-classical level. which means that there is quite a large number of photons or polaritons inside one lattice side. So now the goal of the field, the open question of the field, which is mainly for experimentalists to solve, is to how to make those lattices tight enough so that only one or a few photons can be placed in these lattices, so we can explore strongly correlated states with this platform. However, already, even without this tight confinement, already those photons in lattices or polaritons in lattices have been used to look at topological states. And in particular, you can imagine that if you create a lattice which is very similar to graphene, so honeycomb structure, lattice with a honeycomb structure, that what happens is that this materials, the graphene material, is a very interesting, has very interesting properties. It has a linear dispersion, the so-called Dirac cone, and the same was possible to achieve in the case of photons. And now, because one can also engineer a spin orbit coupling in the case of these photonic systems, when we place this photonic system inside the magnetic field, it is possible to open a gap in the spectrum and then create the edge states which will be inside the gap. And that what it means is that if you initiate a current going around, so let's say you have your lattice and you initiate a current which would a flow of these photonic particles, if you can achieve topologically protected state, it would mean that if you inject the current in one direction, even if it meets some other some obstacle, some dirt, some imperfection at the edge, it will just always flow around in one direction and will not flow in the other direction. There will be no scattering back. So these topologically protected states are quite of interest in the community for encoding information, let's say, in the direction of that flow. So basically, this photonic quantum fluids not only allow the realization of the superfluidity and the study of superfluid properties such as vortices, quantum turbulence, it's now moving into the area of quantum simulations where they can be placed in lattices and simulate hopefully strongly correlated states soon, but topological states already.